Greetings, welcome to today's lecture. We will start learning about brake system from today's class, which is a part of module. Till now we have studied the powertrain, we have studied the internal combustion engine, and then we looked at the transmission. If you look at the powertrain essentially converts the chemical energy into heat energy in the IC engine, and then the heat energy is converted into kinetic energy, which is transported to wheels to propel the vehicle. So in a broad sense, if you look at the energy conversion mechanism, it is from chemical energy to thermal energy, from thermal energy to kinetic energy in a conventional powertrain, which we have learned till now. From today's class onwards, we learn about brakes. Brake is in a certain sense is just a complement of what happens in the powertrain. And what we are going to learn, we'll encounter other types of braking system also. We are going to learn what is called as a friction braking. In a friction braking, kinetic energy of the vehicle is converted into a thermal energy and it is dissipated to the atmosphere. So that is what happens in a friction braking. Is in a certain sense, in a powertrain, we have chemical energy to thermal energy to kinetic energy. Here you have kinetic energy converted into a thermal energy and dissipated to the atmosphere. So we can see that it performs in a complementary way, right? So brake is a device used to slow down, stopping and controlling the vehicle. Braking operations is based on conversion of kinetic energy of the vehicle into heat, which is dissipated to the atmosphere while driving the vehicle. The torque of the engine produces tractive effort due to the periphery of the driving vehicle. When the brakes are applied to, it produces negative traction effort on the wheel while it helps to slow down the vehicle. On the other hand, brakes are something which are hardly to see it in the bare eyes. So now let us articulate what is the function of a brake system. So it is very intuitive that we understand what is a brake system, right? Because of particular road vehicles which are usually we come across in a day-to-day life, we have an intuition of understanding it better. Let us formally write down a few more things. If a brake should be able to decelerate the vehicle and stop the function when necessary, it means that this should provide sufficient braking force and that is an important requirement. Because in order to achieve a certain deceleration and stop the vehicle, the brake system should have enough capacity to provide the necessary braking force. Then a brake should also help us in maintaining the speed of the vehicle while traveling downhill. The brake should be applied often to ensure that the vehicle is in controllable speed, so that we can take turns and navigate the narrow roads when we come downhill right from the hill, right? This should imply that yes, brakes should have enough capacity, but if you look at the friction braking, what is going to happen is that the kinetic energy is converted into heat energy and dissipated, and what is going to happen to the brake competence? The temperature are going to get hotter, and we are dealing with a friction material where the temperature of the friction material will reach to a higher levels. One wants to meet this expectation of the brake should be able to dissipate it at the heat energy effectively. Okay, so that means the temperature should be maintained at a reasonable level. That is also an important part. Then the brake system should also able to hold a vehicle stationary on the slope. This is a very important right. When we are on a due reason to park, or when we are waiting in a traffic, we should ensure that the vehicle does not roll down. Okay, the brake system should also able to hold the vehicle stationary. That's an understanding on a gradient. These are some functions that we are going to see how these functions have been realized. Shortly before, let us go and then vehicles to the friction brakes, and we'll go for comparison of that particular brake system. When you talk about the evolution of the brakes, how did the brakes evolve? So initially what happened was the wheels were braked by a mechanism where all it was complete a mechanical component. They were braked by wedging a shoe against the rim. So if we observe this, this component as an wheel which was wedged with an a friction material which was operated by a lever. So the lever could actuate the braking packs which comes in contact with the wheel, and then it slows down, right? So what is mean that if you say that if you compress, I mean compare a horse driven carriage, or if you have a wheel, that is typically what happens is that the brake shoe is that is necessarily controlled by a lever which goes under the control of the driver. It goes upstream, and when the driver activates the lever, the wedge is going to be pushed against the wheel and generates a friction that where the initial mechanism, this was the initial mechanism that was used. It was okay for the wheels which was not pneumatic in the sense, right? But if we move, we have moved to the pneumatic tires. Once we have moved to the pneumatic tires, wedging mechanism on the periphery is not practical, because applying the pressure on the external surface of the pneumatic tire could eventually burst up the surface. That we do not expect it, right? From the transition, what is called as then came in transition, what is called as an externally contacting brakes, or it just basically realized as what is called as band brakes. These band brakes are externally contacting brakes, wherein we see a band that runs in between the brake lining and the wheel hub. As the wheel hub rotates, wheel hub keeps on rotating. When we bring down the band, braking band in contact with the wheel hub, it contracts, that pulls the material with the operation of this lever, that contracts the material and then causes the friction in it. That can be the friction material expand on inside of the drum. There can be a chance that when a friction material can expand from the inside of the drum and they contract the internal surface of the drum rather than external surface. That led to what is called as an internally expanding brakes. What we typically see or we typically say, we call them as an drum brakes. So this is a drum brake which we see here, where we have got a drum on the external surface and a pivot that runs a brake shoes. In between the brake shoe and the drum, we got the friction material. So when the brakes are applied, the pivots activate the or pushes the pivot towards brake shoes towards the drum, wherein comes in contact with the friction material, applying the friction, thereby providing the required braking force. So here essentially what is happening is the pulling out is happening from the inner side. So we call it as an the expansion is happening from the inner side. We call them as an internally expanding brake. These are the few constructions which we can see. There we have got a rear axle to which it is put it with the backing plate and the brake shoes and the brake drum, what you call it, right? So the drum brakes are used along with the disc brakes. In nowadays we try to use it as an along with the disc brake as a common friction brakes in the road vehicles. You will study both the detail, but the idea is to have a sort of arrangement that in wherein we have done external friction material, so that we can see that the brake shoes are pivoted on a backing plate, and when apply the force at the free end of the shoe, what happens is that the brake lining is then pushed against the drum, rotating drum, right? The drum is rotating along with the wheel. This is the diagram which dissipates it. In this usually in this case, the brake shoes are actuated by mechanical means and contact by the inside of the brake drum. The rods and the levers decrease the pedal effort required by the driver through mechanical advantage. On the front axle, the back plate is fixed to the steering knuckle through the bolts. When you come to the types of brakes, we have a larger categorization of brakes based on various function. On the basis purpose served, we call them as an primary and secondary brakes. Primary are brakes or the service brakes or the main brakes, which are used to stop the vehicle within a minimum possible distance when the vehicle is in motion. Secondary brakes are the parking brakes, which are used to hold the vehicles on a slope and when it is stationary. on the basis of location or location in the vehicle. We have wheel mounted brakes, transmission mounted brakes. On the basis of driver's ergonomics, we call it some foot brakes and hand brakes. We usually have these two combination of brakes in most of the vehicles. On the basis of actuating method, it's mechanical brakes or hydraulic brakes, compressed air brakes, vacuum brakes or pneumatic brakes, even it's an electric brakes also. On the basis of construction, we have got drum brakes, disc brakes and band brakes. On the basis of application of braking effort, manual brakes, servo brakes, power brakes, and on the basis of action of the brake shoes, what we discussed right now as an internal expanding brakes and external expanding brakes. On the combination, we have got drum and disc combination brakes, mechanical and hydro combination brakes, and specifically engine exhaust operated brakes, pneumatic hydro brakes, and hill holding brakes. This is the types of brakes what we discussed. The types of drum brakes can be once again classified based on one leading shoe and one trailing shoe. That's what we see in the shoes, the type of arrangements in the shoes, right? One leading and the other one trailing means that one part of this shoe, the half of the shoe, will be the first element that expands during the application of brake in case of one leading shoe and one trailing shoe. In the two leading shoes, both the shoes are actuated, that pushes out from the inner inward radially outward direction. So single leading shoes, what you got, it's an another type. The twin leading shoes, that's a discuss what we talked as an one leading and two leading shoes. Brake shoes arrangement consist of shoes and arrangements of the relative torque activity on the brake shoes of the same force applied by the pedal changes depending upon whether the expander which forces the brake shoe is fixed on the back plate or kept floating. The types of drum brakes, what we have already discussed about this. Then we come to the disc brake. Essentially, the disc brake is a part of this drum brake itself, wherein we have got a disc that is connected to a rotor or a wheel hub, which is been brought into a stopping caliper with the help of brake pads, right? So instead of drum, we use a disc in this case. It's a typical figure of a disc brake, just fitted with a caliper. So where A is a piston that actuates the friction pad towards the revolving disc, which when it comes in contact with the friction, the friction of contact, the coefficient of friction is more, it brings the shaft or revolving shaft to a stationary position. The disc brake differs from the drum brakes in the use of heavy disc or rotor. The disc is bolted to the wheel hub and revolves within it. The caliper is stationary housing connected to the axle casing, consisting of two hydraulic pistons at the end of which the brake friction pads are attached. Disc brakes are as an excellent cooling characteristics, making it highly resistant to brake fade. When the brakes are applied, hydraulic pressure activates piston and the friction pads are focused inward against the revolving disc, providing braking effort. This is the types of disc brake based on the caliper type. So you got a swinging caliper type, wherein we see that the friction pad and the disc is being added to a caliper which swings the top, right? And we got a sliding caliper where we have got the caliper comes as a whole component, one single component that holds the disc in between them. So it's a vented disc brake and solid disc brake also. So when you try to compare between the drum brake and the disc brake, we have got many points to be considered. When you talk to the life of frictional material, it's reasonable in case of drum brake, reasonably more in terms of disc brake. The visibility of wear from the outside is not possible in case of drum brake since it is put in with an encasing. Disc brake can be seen at a glance. The heat dissipation is very inferior in case of drum brake and better in case of disc brake. So replacement of friction materials, the troubleshooting and time taking and easily and rapid, weight bulkier, the drum brakes are bulkier, the disc brakes are lighter. Cooling very slow, you can have a very efficient cooling mechanism in case of disc brake. Water and dust collection accumulates in case of drum. In case of a disc brake, it can be a self-cleaning mechanism also. The braking effort is generally inconsistent in case of drum brake and it is very consistent in case of disc brake. As we said, the temperature is a severe problem that causes the lower performance of the drum brake. In a disc brake, it is unaffected. Self-energizing action exists. and it is absent in the disc brake. Brake pedal effects is higher proportional to retardation. Behavior of hydraulic system is in some pressure always exists. No hydraulic pressure exists in case of piston. Force needed to apply the brake is comparatively less in case of drum brake, more in case of disc brake, since brakes are not self-energizing. Nature of wear, not uniform in case of drum brake. In case of disc brake, it's uniform. Shape of the friction lining is curved and straight in disc brake. In a mechanical brakes, the pressure from usually mechanical brakes, the pressure from the brake pedal is transmitted to the wheel brakes through rods and shaft and cables and or cables and shafts. The shoes are operated against the revolving drum by cams or toggle lever. These cams or toggles levers are in turn operated by various mechanical linkages. The mechanical linkages also multiplies the pedal force through leverage to obtain effective braking effort against the drum. This is the diagram dissipating the mechanical brakes, wherein got a lever to activate the brake rods through a brake pedal where it actuates the drum brake. So this is another diagram dissipating the mechanical expander brake, this cam operated and toggle lever operated. So the way the retracting springs, I mean, or the way the shoes are actuated. So here it is driven by the cam, here it is driven by the toggle lever. Toggle lever is simply hand lever, what you got here. As I said, it's mainly consisted of an expander and adjuster. The expander provides the actuating force required to operate the brake shoes, and adjuster compensates the wear in the friction line. The two types of brakes alone. Another mechanical brake is grilling mechanical brake. So in a grilling mechanical brake, we have got a servo brake system. Any mechanism that supplements the driver effort in applying brake system as a servo mechanism. Braking effort increases with the weight of the vehicle. After a particular limit, it becomes impossible for the driver alone to apply a brake effort. The brake effort may be considerably reduced by using servo action or self-energizing brakes. In servo brakes, we got vacuum servo brakes. In vacuum servo brakes, the brakes are applied by utilizing the engine suction from the inlet. Small vacuum reservoir may be provided to have enough vacuum for several brakes applications even after engine has stopped. Vacuum servo brakes are of two types. One is of using piston, other one is using a diaphragm. In the piston type, both sides of the piston are atmospheric pressure. Vacuum by the engine suction is applied on one side and resulting in the braking. The second type, also referred as suspended vacuum system, both sides of the piston are subjected to vacuum when the brakes are in a released position. When the brakes are applied, one side of the piston is exposed to the atmospheric pressure, and the differential pressure on the both sides of the piston causes the linkage to operate. This system is more rapid in operation and hence preferred over the first type. And the second type is called as suspended vacuum system. When brake pedal is free, the upper valve of the control unit is closed. When the brake pedal is pressed, the hydraulic fluid forces the lower valve shut and opens the upper valve, exposing the left side of the piston in a servo cylinder to the atmospheric pressure. This results in piston movement towards right. The movement is utilized in applying brakes by a suitable linkage by a mechanical or which might be a mechanical or hydraulic. This is the diagram dissipating a master cylinder which consists of a brake pedal which actuates a master cylinder from which a vacuum from which the brake fluid actuates the servo cylinder in order to cause a vacuum in between them. So the vacuum reservoir is there, a non-return valve is fitted on there. It creates the difference of the pressure makes the application of the brake in this case of system. So instead of having a servo, if we try to use a hydraulic liquid, then we call them as a hydraulic braking system. Hydraulic braking system makes use of a master cylinder which contains a reservoir of brake fluid. The master cylinder is operated by a brake pedal. The master cylinder is connected to wheel cylinders in each wheel via steel pipelines and flexible hose. Master cylinder is a very important component. It is the heart of the hydraulic braking system in which hydraulic pressure is developed. Its working is similar to a pump and converts the mechanical force of the brake pedal into a hydraulic pressure. It consists of two main chambers, the fluid reservoir and the compression chamber. The fluid in the reservoir compresses the fluid volume, changes the pipelines. The rubber seals are provided on both edges of the piston in order to have a better. System usually works with a smaller pressure of 50 kilopascal. The movement of the piston in the mass cylinder causes the piston in the wheel cylinders to move until the brake shoes engage a revolving or a revolving brake drum. This is the diagram dissipating the hydraulic brake. Hydraulic brakes continue. This is the diagram for hydraulic brakes. The master cylinder. As a pedal is pushed, the piston moves against the spring until bypass port is closed. Further movement results in the buildup of pressure. When the pressure exceeds a sufficient value, the check valve is deflected, forcing the pressurized fluid to the wheel cylinders via pipelines. As a pedal is released, the spring forces the piston to fight to relieve the pressure. So air brakes. Air brakes are pneumatic brakes or compressed air brakes where it uses the air. It is more or less very much similar to an hydraulic brake. First, we will see the schematic. It consists of a filter and compressor connected to a reservoir. From the reservoir, it gives to the compressed air to the brake valve using a different brake chambers. As I said, it's similar to a hydraulic brake, except that the hydraulic fluid is replaced by a compressed air. Air is compressed in the compressor. Compressed air reaches the reservoir through an unloader valve. Unloader valve opens the predetermined pressure of 900 kPa. The compressed air is distributed to brake chambers at each wheel. The reservoir pressure decreases when the brakes are applied. When the reservoir pressure decreases below 700 kPa, the governor cuts the compressor to raise the system pressure. A warning is given when the pressure drops below 400 kPa. This is a schematic showing a pneumatic brake system wherein we have got a stop light switch or a brake valve to be activated. We have got the four wheels which has been adjusted with a chamber, a common pneumatic line that connects with the drain tank from the compressor. The compressor runs based on the engine power and compresses the air and then provides the air, compressed air towards to the different quick release valve. From the quick release valve, the air, compressed air, is provided at the various drums to apply the brakes. So we have learned today regarding the different types of braking system, the function of a braking system. Later we saw few types of braking system. In the further classes, we'll learn about the anti-lock braking system, which is another version of braking system, which is a very important category, which we will learn in the next class. Okay, thank you.